Good morning. This is Newsline. My name is Sonali Vanigabaduke. We have with us in our studios a very special guest. He's a prolific writer in Hindi, Marathi, and Urdu, and has composed over 500 compositions in Hindi and Urdu with equal command, portraying the various shades of human emotions spanning over a broad spectrum of subjects such as philosophy, religion, and current affairs. He's also a sixth generation spiritual leader. I'm so pleased to welcome to our News First studios in Colombo, Swami Nyanraj Manik Prabhu Maharaj. Good morning and welcome morning. To the
Vanakkam,
show.
Vanakkam.
Vanakkam. And thank you so much for being here with us.
It's my pleasure.
This is your first visit to Sri Lanka,
Swami. Yeah, it's my first visit to Sri Lanka. And when I was a child, when I was studying geography, I would wonder, why this is called Sri Lanka? Because Australia is not called Sri Australia.
Right.
Or America is not called Sri America. UK is not called Sri UK. Even India is not called Sri India or Sri Bharat. Mm. But Sri Lanka is called Sri Lanka. The Sri prefix to this name of this nation. The idea of Sri is prosperity, glory, beauty. All these things mean Sri. And that prefix, after coming here, and seeing this country and its beautiful people and the beautiful landscape and the cleanliness and the affectionate people of Sri Lanka, I have come to the conclusion that that prefix Sri is very apt for Sri Lanka.
All right. Swamiji, you practice a philosophy named Advaita Vedanta, which has its roots in Hinduism.
Yeah.
Could you explain and elaborate on this philosophy?
Advaita philosophy. Actually, this Advaita philosophy has come down from the Upanishads, right, from the ancient ages. Shankaracharya expounded it through his literature, through his commentaries, through his bhashyams and all that. And it is popularly associated with Shankaracharya. But it is not, it didn't begin with Shankaracharya. It has been very, from the ancient times in the Vedas, this Advaita philosophy has been there.
Right.
In the Rig Veda, there is a famous saying, where the rishis said, "Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti." The absolute truth, the truth is one, but the wise men call it by different names. So Advaita means non-duality.
Right.
There are no two things in this world. There is only one thing in this world.
So oneness.
Oneness.
Right.
That is Advaita. And through Advaita, all the differences and all the divisions, they get withered away. When I know that you are me and I am you, then that difference will not be there. That hatred will not be there. We'll have mutual love, we'll have mutual respect. It is very practical. It is the essence of the Vedas. Advaita philosophy is the essence of the Vedas.
Swamiji, today more than ever before, we need for these feelings of oneness to be propagated among people, not just living in one particular geographical location, but across the world. We see so much of xenophobic sentiment, so much of hatred.
Yeah.
How do we go
that
about overcoming
this? That is because of ignorance.
This?
That is because, firstly, it is because of ignorance. And secondly, it is because of politics.
Sure.
People by nature are very, very, you see, we are all children of God. If you see a small child, it doesn't hate anyone.
Yeah.
As the child grows, people start teaching the child that this is not good, he is not good, she is not good and all that. And that way the child develops hatred. A small child does not have hatred.
Sure.
Similarly, we are all children of God and we are all children of one God. That is very important. And this hatred and all what we are seeing nowadays, that has been there for the ages. And it has been there. It has been there because of politics. Even in the during Mahabharata, you saw so much of adharma. That was because of politics only.
Right.
So there is a way out. Every lock has been designed to have a key. Every problem has a solution. So there is a way out. You should not get despaired by the situation. There is a way out.
Swamiji, how do you think religious leaders need to come together in order to educate people on this concept of oneness, on this concept of compassion for fellow human beings? Because this is something that we see as lacking in society.
Yeah. They need to come together. And there have been many efforts in that line. But unfortunately, people have their own egos, their small little egos.
Sure.
They don't allow them to come together. But our effort and our aim is to bring all the leaders, all the spiritual leaders on one platform. Because you need to understand that God is one. You can call him by any name in any language. You can call him Khuda in Arabic, or you can call him Allah, or you can call him God in English. You can call him Parabrahma, Paramatma in Sanskrit. You can call him by any name, but the essence, the true essence is one. It is just like gold being one and the various ornaments being called by different names.
Right.
But it is only names and forms that are different.
Sure.
The essence is one. The essence is one.
Swamiji, you're a sixth generation spiritual leader,
yeah,
which means you come with so many decades and decades of experience,
yeah,
in this field of spirituality. Do you find that people across the board are more drawn towards spirituality now than before, or less drawn towards spirituality?
People are more drawn towards spirituality nowadays because,
okay,
there's a lot of stress, there's,
sure,
a lot of tension, and they want to get rid of that stress and tension.
Right.
That draws them towards spirituality.
Okay.
And more and more people are coming into this path, and it's a very positive development.
Okay. So you specifically spoke about workplace stressors and,
yeah,
tensions.
Yeah.
The man or woman of today is burdened with,
yeah,
too much,
yeah,
to handle,
yeah,
which is why we require this,
yeah,
spirituality concept to be,
yeah,
ingrained.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
However, do you think that the school system adequately addresses this? Because we find that mental health, for example,
yeah,
is,
yeah,
an area which is not given attention. As a result of which we see children committing suicide,
yeah,
suffering from depression, etc. So when a child is drawn towards spirituality,
yeah,
the child is guided.
Yeah.
How do we reconcile this?
I think it in this way. In the school, everything is taught. They teach you to talk, they teach you to write, they teach you to read, they teach you to do so many things. They,
mm-hmm,
teach you to play football, cricket, everything.
Sure.
But they don't teach you to think. No one teaches you to think. How to think? That's a very important aspect. And that can be done only through spirituality. Spirituality teaches you to think, because it trains your mind also, not only your body. It trains your mind, it trains your soul also.
Mm-hmm.
So spirituality is a very important aspect which is being ignored by the various governments. Even in India also, they are ignoring spirituality in textbooks, in schools, colleges. Whenever you talk about spirituality, then the question of religion comes.
Sure.
And state being secular, they think that spiritual education should not be imparted.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the wrong thing to do. They should inculcate spirituality among small children right from the beginning, so that they have a feeling of oneness. They should know their own self, because in the Upanishads it is said, tamatmastham yenu pashyanti dhiraha tesham sukham shashvatam netaresham. The one who sees the Lord in his own self, only that person is happy. Others are not happy.
Swamiji, another aspect that we see in society is that we sort of ignore perpetrators of crimes. For example, if we visit a prison,
okay,
in a city,
okay,
we find that these people have been sort of segregated from society,
yeah, yeah,
and shunned and outcast.
Yeah. Yeah.
And no real efforts are being taken to rehabilitate them in the holistic sense of the word.
Yes, yes, yes.
Swamiji, what you practice, how can that be incorporated into their lives?
You are absolutely right, because the very purpose of keeping a person in a prison is to educate him so that he doesn't commit the same crime once again.
Sure.
That is the very purpose of keeping a person in prison. But now keeping a person in prison has become a punishment. There is no use punishing people.
Mm.
You should educate them, you should try to rehabilitate them. And for that, the spiritual leaders must visit prisons. That's very important. Because once if they go to the prisons and talk to the inmates who are there, I think there'll be some definite positive development, and they'll repent for what they have done. That sense of repentance has to be inculcated among the inmates of the prison. That's called paschatapam in Sanskrit. You should seek forgiveness from the Lord for what you have done. And to do that, I think spiritual leaders should visit the prisons regularly, on a regular basis. And the government should encourage it. Unfortunately, the governments in our subcontinent, they are not encouraging such things.
Swamiji, in your opinion, what role must a government play in also identifying spirituality as an important and pivotal aspect in governance itself? Because they say, mens sana in corpore sano, a healthy mind in a healthy body. So in order to have a healthy mind, you need aspects such as spirituality. So what role must the government play in maybe engaging spiritual leaders more in aspects of governance?
Yeah, they should include the spiritual leaders in aspects of government. But I think it should be on an advisory level. Spiritual leaders should not get into politics.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, what is happening is they are getting into politics.
Mm-hmm.
From the early Vedic days also, we had these Raj Gurus and Raj Rishis.
Right.
Who used to advise the king on various aspects.
Okay.
But nowadays what is happening is the spiritual gurus themselves are getting into politics.
Right.
That's not right. They should not get into politics. They should advise the government on what is right and what is wrong. Their role should be limited to that aspect only.
Sure. I'm actually glad you brought in that aspect, because we see this happening.
Yeah.
And we see that sometimes people develop a certain mistrust about spiritual leaders because of their involvement in politics, directly or indirectly.
Yeah.
So how do you reconcile between those?
A true seeker who is deep into spirituality, he won't do all these things. Only the shallow-minded people, some of them do it. But these type of people are there in every field of life.
Sure.
You cannot only blame the spiritual sector for it.
Sure.
Because every walk of life, there are people. In politics also there are black sheep. In media also there are black sheep,
sure,
if I may say so. And in politics, in sports, everywhere there are corrupt people, there are black sheep everywhere. But you cannot blame the entire community for it.
Right, of course. Let's talk a bit more about the Advaita Vedanta philosophy.
Yeah.
In the pragmatic sense of the word, how does one go about following this philosophy? If you could just
I'll give you a small example. Dvaita means difference or division. Advaita means there is no difference at all, there is no division at all.
Okay.
All the religions in the world, they believe in the Dvaita philosophy. All the religions except a segment of the Hinduism, they all believe in Dvaita philosophy. Dvaita philosophy is God is someone different who is sitting in the heavens and he is ruling over the world, and a sort of a king ruling over a continent or a country like that. But Dvaita philosophy, in Dvaita philosophy they say, we don't want to become sugar, we want to eat sugar. In Advaita philosophy what is said is, we have to become God. Actually you don't need to become God, you have to realize that you are God yourself. That is the essence of Advaita philosophy. And Advaita philosophy gives the example of eating sugar. You see, until and unless you eat sugar and that sugar dissolves into your system, you won't get that bliss, you won't get that joy, you won't get the happiness.
Right.
So Advaita philosophy sees God as the consciousness that pervades our body.
Sure.
The consciousness in our body is nothing else but God, because Pradnyanam Brahma, this is what the Vedas have proclaimed. The consciousness itself is God. So all this body, which is, you see, a corpse is there. There's a dead body. And there's a living person. What is the difference between a corpse and a living person? The living person can eat, he can smell, he can talk, he can walk, he can smile, he can cry. He can do everything. That is because of his consciousness. It is like electricity. Electricity pervading a bulb.
Right.
So this body is like a bulb. And the electricity is that spark that illumines this body which is already dead. This is a dead body. But that spark is there. And that because of that spark I can talk to you. Because of the spark you can listen to me. You can smile. You can cry. You can eat. You can sleep. You can get up. You can play. You can do everything. Every activity is dependent on the spark. And that spark is God. That is what is said in the Advaita philosophy. And that is yourself. That is your inner essence. That is your inner. Without that you cannot be.
Right. Swamiji, let's speak about the samsthan.
Yeah.
If you could elaborate
I'll
as
tell
to
you,
what
I'll tell
exactly
you.
Manikprabhu that is.
Maharaj, 200 years ago, he took birth in the Hyderabad state, in the Nizam state in India. And he is regarded or hailed as the incarnation of Lord Dattatreya. And he was a saint of great spirituality. And he established the Samsthan in the year 1845. Samsthan word actually means an institution,
okay.
A religious institution, a spiritual institution. He established the Samsthan in 1845.
Right.
And he propagated the message of universal brotherhood, love, harmony amongst all religions. He brought Hindus and Muslims together. He brought Sikhs and Parsis together. And he inculcated a feeling of oneness among all the religions.
Mm-hmm.
There's a story about him. A Muslim person was very influenced by his knowledge of the Quran. And he came and requested Prabhu Maharaj and said, can you accept Islam? So Prabhu said, why should I accept Islam? Why should I accept? I have already accepted it.
Mm-hmm.
There's no need to accept it again, once again. Islam is in the mind, it is in the thinking. And he gave a quotation from the Quran. He said, Rabbul Alameen, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, Rabbul Alameen. Rabbul Alameen means God is one and he is the master of the world. Nowhere in the Quran it has been said that God is the master of only the Muslims. God is the master of all the entire humanity. So what is the need to accept some other religion or change over to some other religion? Even Hinduism says that. Christianity also says that. Islam also says that. It is there in all the books. So that way he conveyed the message of humanity, the message of universal brotherhood, love and all that. And he established his own stand to propagate this message in the year 1845. And since then there has been a continued line of acharyas.
Right.
who have carried on the work of Manikprabhu Maharaj. And I have the good fortune of heading that institution as a sixth Pithadipati. And we are carrying out many educational activities, many charitable activities, and many social activities. We are running an orphanage, we are running a Veda Pathshala, which is a huge Pathshala, supposed to be one of the largest in the entire state of Karnataka.
Right.
We are running a number of educational institutions and we have taken up many social projects also, apart from the spiritual and religious aspect
sure.
that we are doing.
Right, so education is also
education,
an aspect
education
that
and social,
on.
Social also.
Right.
Afforestation, then climate, all these things we are doing. We are doing a lot of work. Manikprabhu Samsthan is doing a lot. It's a premier socio-spiritual organization. In India.
Swamiji, we find that the West is also moving towards these Eastern values of spirituality and
yeah.
it's quite widely practiced
yes,
now.
Yes.
How do you see this?
It's a very positive sign, and today being the World Yoga Day, today is the World Yoga Day.
Sure.
So yoga is a very important aspect of our Oriental philosophy. And people are accepting yoga. And yoga does not only mean physical exercises and breathing exercises. There are 8 steps in yoga. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dharana, dhyana and samadhi.
Mm-hmm.
Samadhi is the culmination of yoga. And people are, at least they have started to understand the importance of yoga. And that's a very positive sign. And through yoga, if the Western people can come to India, and take the knowledge of the Vedas and Upanishads, I would be very happy to see people practicing Advaita Vedanta in the West also. People are already practicing Advaita Vedanta.
Right. Okay. Swamiji, I'd also like to bring your attention back to this concept of hatred and xenophobic sentiment that is pervading much of the world, especially in the West, in countries like the United States of America, for example. We see so much of hatred and extremism, which has now become a threat to world peace.
Yes.
As a spiritual leader, what message do you think we as human beings, we as a society, need to be mindful of? What are we doing wrong?
The first thing, basic thing that we are doing wrong is we are not trying to understand what is our true nature.
Mm-hmm.
Our true nature is consciousness. Every being in the world, every human being is endowed with a consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
If we understand consciousness is one. The consciousness pervading my body is the same as the consciousness pervading your body.
Mm-hmm.
So if you understand that, I won't have any hatred towards you. But what I see, I see myself only as my body.
Mm-hmm.
That is the problem. If I see myself as only my body, then there will be a hatred, then there will be a difference of color, then there is language, then there is religion, then there is caste, then there is so many things, so many nationalities, so many things. But the consciousness that pervades all the bodies, not only the human bodies, but the animals and plants and everything. So that consciousness is one, that has to be understood.
Swamiji, so how do we, in order to solve this age-old issue of hatred, of racism, how do we sort of break it down, in your opinion? If consciousness is what we need to be mindful of, then where should it start? Is it from home or is it from school? Who should we educate in order to ensure that society is rid of
hatred? It should start simultaneously at home also, at school also. Actually, the parents should educate their children first. Then the schools also should inculcate this feeling. And the reading of scriptures is very important. What is happening is, even in other Hinduism also, and even in other religions, people don't read scriptures.
Sure.
If you be a true Muslim or a true Christian or a true Hindu, you won't hate anyone.
Right.
People, the problem is they are not true Hindus, they are not true Muslims, they are not true Christians. That is why they are hating each other. If you are a true Buddhist, if you are a true Hindu, if you are a true Christian, you won't hate anyone because Bible doesn't teach to hate.
Sure.
It says love thy neighbor.
Mm.
Even Islam is a religion of peace and love.
Sure.
Buddhism is a dharma of ahimsa and shanti and prem.
Mm.
And all the religions in the world, they teach the same thing. I give an example of a cricket field. In a cricket match, there are about 9 fielders.
Right.
There are 9 fielders.
Okay.
A bowler and the wicket keeper, if you leave them,
mm-hmm.
there will be 9 fielders.
Mm-hmm.
If they are placed on the boundary line,
mm-hmm.
the difference between each fielder is much more.
Mm-hmm.
As and when they close in, the difference gets reduced. Then again the captain calls them to close in. The difference is much reduced.
Mm.
Then again, when they come onto the pitch, there's no difference at all. If you follow your own religion in the true sense of it, you will not hate anyone. Mm. The problem is people don't follow their own religion, they just hate others.
Sure.
So people need to follow their own religion, therefore people need to follow their own philosophy with the true sense of it.
And also, Swamiji, we find that there's a lot of misinterpretation of religion. So we find people claiming that they are doing certain negative things in the name of their religion, which is completely a misrepresentation. Because just as you said, religion teaches man to be good and compassionate and merciful. However, this misinterpretation of spiritual texts is a huge issue that we face.
Actually, man is an animal. He is an animal.
Mm.
Religion has converted him into man. Actually, he is an animal. But religion has converted him into man.
Mm. And, by providing the guidance.
Mm. And these people who are misrepresenting religion, they are all uneducated people. They are not educated in the true sense. Because to be a guru, you have to be a shishya first. You have to be a disciple first. And you have to study under the guidance of a competent guru for a stretch of time, for a long time. First you have to be a disciple, then only you can be a guru. Mm-hmm. And nowadays gurus are mushrooming all over. Every day you find a new guru who is commenting on religion. I don't think that that's right. You should first study the scriptures. You should first study the scriptures. You should undergo training under a spiritual master. And then only you can be a guru. The word guru itself means vrinati atma tattvam upadishati ti guruhu. Guru is one who imparts self-knowledge. Mm-hmm. So the guru has to himself take that self-knowledge from his guru. Mm-hmm. So that is missing. Unfortunately, that is missing, and people are attracted towards people who can do miracles and you can do all sorts of things, all sorts of jugglery. And people get attracted towards all those things.
Swamiji, in order to live a holistic, fulfilling and content life in the modern world, what does a person need to inculcate?
Firstly, you must understand that there is no end to your desires.
Sure.
There is no end to it. And our society is becoming consumerist day and day. There are so many advertisements. A small toothpaste, there will be about 100 varieties. Mm. A small soap, there will be about 200 varieties. Mm. Mobile phone, there will be about 500 varieties.
Sure.
And people get attracted to these things. But actually, these things don't give you happiness. The happiness has to be sought within. It doesn't come from objects of the world. Mm. Because the objects of the world, they don't have happiness in it. You buy any product from the market, and there will be labels, protein 6% and carbohydrate 12%, sugar 2%. And happiness, 0.6%, it is not written. Happiness is not there in the object.
Sure.
Happiness is a state of mind that you have to inculcate from within.
Sure.
Because when you go to sleep, in deep sleep, you don't have any objects, but you get happiness. From where does that happiness come? Mm-hmm. That is your inbuilt happiness. That is your Atmananda that is there. So you need to understand that objects of the world cannot give you happiness. They can never give you happiness. Suppose I buy a car today, tomorrow I would like to buy some other car, some other model, some other better model, some other better model. And it is endless. You go on purchasing things, and the next day you will find your neighbor has a better thing, and that happiness comes to an end as soon as you know that someone else has a better thing. So this consumerism is spoiling our thinking and our... And that is the main reason of the stress also. Mm. Stress and tension is coming because of consumerism. I want to be better than someone else. I want to be better than my neighbor. I want to be better than my family members. And that race, and you see the race horses, and they are sweating and running and running and running. They don't have peace. They don't have any happiness. They don't have any, shanti. So it is bound to happen in consumerist society. For that you should settle down, sit down quietly, think over, okay, what is the nature of happiness? Nature of happiness is inside, it is not outside.
So seek happiness within, not without.
Yes, yes.
Swamiji, your final words for the Sri Lankans watching us now on live TV across TV1. My final question to you, are you hopeful for humankind?
I am hopeful. Because there have been so many attempts in the past also to eradicate and to finish this religious hatred and all that. And they have been successful. There have been great spiritual masters who have been successful. Mm-hmm. And that line is continuing, and that work is continuing. And I hope people will understand. Ultimately, they have to understand. They don't have any other choice. Otherwise, they'll go into stress and depression and all sorts of things. And I wish the people of Sri Lanka all the very best in material happiness and spiritual bliss. And what I find, after coming to Sri Lanka, I find people are more interested in spirituality. And the best thing that I saw after coming to Colombo is Buddha everywhere. Buddha is an apostle of peace, love, and I could see the statues of Buddha everywhere. And I am hopeful and I am sure Sri Lanka is going to prosper, not only materially, but spiritually also Sri Lanka will prosper. It has been prospering, and for the last 8 or 10 years, what I am seeing is your progress has been very fast. If I may say so, it has been faster than India.
Swamiji, thank you very much for
my
your
pleasure.
Presence
you
here
so
today.
And I convey the blessings of Manikprabhu Maharaj to all the people of Sri Lanka.
Thank you very much. Swami Nyanraj Manikprabhu Maharaj joining us on Newsline. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again tomorrow.
Yeah.